Hello and welcome to Worship Online with Upper Clyde Parish Church, where we mark Transfiguration Sunday, Jesus upon the mountaintop, who in the mystery and in glory meets with Elijah and Moses, while Peter, James and John look on in confusion and astonishment. At this time, we cannot be unaware of what is unfolding in Ukraine, and our hearts go out to all who are caught up in this war. We stand with you, and you are in our prayers. Some church notices. This evening at 5 p.m. at Leadhills Village Hall, we'll be having a time of worship, and this evening will be a time of reflection and time for prayers for peace as we think about what's been happening in Ukraine. A reminder to everyone that this coming Sunday is Communion Sunday, and in the building we'll be sharing together at the Lord's table. So if you're able to attend in person, it will be really good to see you. And please do let others know, the folks you think would want to be coming along. For those of you who are worshipping online, my apologies to you, as we don't have the capacity to stream the service live. We'll be having a slightly different time together in our worship, but however we gather and however we worship, we are still one in Christ. This coming Sunday also ushers in the season of Lent, a time of reflection, a time of preparation, where we mark a spiritual journey, walking the way with Jesus to Jerusalem. And next week also, as it's Communion Sunday, we're going to be reintroducing our food bank box in the church building, and that will be there over the Sundays of March. And for those of you online who would like to help, there's a direct link to the donation page for Clydesdale Food Bank, which is scrolling at the bottom of this page. Thanks in advance for your kindness and your generosity. I'm always blown away by just how much you give to the food bank. It's impressive. As far as I'm aware, these are all our church notices. So as we move into our time of worship, let's be still a moment and let's take time to prepare ourselves to meet with God in this time. Let's be still. Our call to worship. Great is our God. Come and worship. Holy is God. Come and praise. Mighty is God. Come and adore. Gathered together, whether virtually or in the church building, we are God's people. So let us worship the one who is worthy of our praise. And our opening hymn is Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise.
Oh,
Let us pray. God of transfiguration and transformation, we worship you this day with songs of praise, with words of power, with listening ears and open hearts. As we reflect this day on Jesus' transfiguration in the presence of Peter, John, and James, may we too be dazzled by your brilliance once more. Lord Jesus, you chose to come back down from the mountain. Forgive us when we limit ourselves to looking for you in elevated places, when you are in fact among us here. Forgiven, loved, and free, open our eyes anew to see you as you continue to walk with us on our journey of life and faith. Freely, gladly, we bring ourselves to you. Merciful God, help us that with all that is within us, we may bless your holy name. Hear us, we pray, in the name of Jesus, your Son, your chosen, to whom we should listen and offer praise and glory now and always, and who taught his friends when praying to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory for ever. Amen.
Luke chapter 9, verses 28 to 43. Now, about 8 days after these sayings, Jesus took with him Peter and John and James and went up to the mountain to pray. And while he was praying, the appearance of his face changed and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly, they saw two men, Moses and Elijah, talking to him. They appeared in glory and were speaking of his departure, which he was about to accomplish at Jerusalem. Now Peter and his companions were weighed down with sleep, but since they had stayed awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. Just as they were leaving, Peter said to Jesus, Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three dwellings. One for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah, not knowing what he said. While he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were terrified as they entered the cloud. Then from the cloud came a voice that said, This is my son, my chosen. Listen to him. When the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone, and they kept silent, and in those days told no one any of the things they had seen. On the next day, when they'd come down from the mountain, a great crowd met him. Just then, a man from the crowd shouted, "Teacher, I beg you to look at my son. He is my only child." Suddenly, a spirit seizes him, and all at once he shrieks. It throws him into convulsions until he foams at the mouth. It mauls him and will scarcely leave him. I begged your disciples to cast it out, but they could not. Jesus answered, "You faithless and perverse generation, how much longer must I be with you and bear with you? Bring your son here." While he was coming, the demon dashed him to the ground in convulsions. But Jesus rebuked the unclean spirit, healed the boy, and gave him back to his father. And all were astounded at the greatness of God. Amen.
Let's pray. In the name of the one whose glory shone upon the mountaintop, we pray. Amen. Scrambling and scrabbling over scree, snaking their way along ridges on the barest of trails, they climb, leaving earthly things behind. Clambering with effort around crags, avoiding cliff edges, looking up occasionally and feeling dizzy, still they follow him. He ascends the heights like Moses did so long ago, he who wrote the law on stone. They pause a while on the mountaintop, almost but not quite the roof of the world, and suddenly the light is blinding, bright, white, searing the scales from the disciples' eyes. And for a moment here, closer to the heavens, they see him for who he truly is, magnificent and glorious, majestic. Shining amid rocky pinnacles, the humble rabbi is transfigured, shot through with shafts of burning, brilliant white, exalted, conversing in illustrious company. Moses, the lawmaker, Elijah, the prophet, return to the mountaintop to meet with the Messiah. Transcendent anointing. Senses ravished by unearthly beauty, desperate to stay, Peter babbles of pitching tents, unable to understand the mystery and the glory of the moment. It passes. They slope back down from the summit, subdued and told to keep the secret, a truth that they cannot comprehend when they descend and are more earthly minded. And only after pain and grief, execution and resurrection, will they truly see him for who he is once more. Strange, dramatic, mysterious and marvelous, this experience on the mountaintop is one of those rare glimpses of Jesus that captures his majesty, his divinity. The ancient creeds of our faith describe Jesus as fully human and fully God. And mostly what we see in scripture is Jesus, the most fully human being there ever was. Sure, there are miracles, but often there's the teaching and the storytelling, the relationships he has with his disciples and the other followers, conversations over meals, and even the occasional teasing of folk. Jesus, eminently relatable, one of us, and that's important. But in our passage today, we also see that other side of his nature, his divinity. Here is Jesus, Messiah, Son of God, the Holy One, Prince of Peace and Redeemer of all humanity. The scene on the mountaintop has been described as a moment in which two worlds meet, in which all worlds meet in the one person of Jesus Christ, and we glimpse what it means that Jesus was fully human and fully divine. Our reading begins by telling us that this experience was about 8 days after these sayings. But what sayings? Well, we have Peter's great declaration about Jesus in chapter 9, verse 20, saying, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." That recognition by Peter that this rabbi was not the usual run-of-the-mill rabbi is an extraordinary statement. But immediately after Peter's declaration come the sayings that our passage refers to. So in verse 21, sayings of Jesus relating to what's to come. He speaks openly of his suffering and his death, and that there will be difficult times ahead for his followers, that they too would suffer. And it rather puts a damper on the moment for Peter. So to our reading today. And roughly 8 days have passed, and Jesus invites Peter, James, and John to go on a bit of a hill walk with him. And Peter's earlier words are shown to ring true. The three disciples see Jesus, his clothes a dazzling white, his face bright. And then Moses and Elijah turn up. The scene is full of Old Testament imagery and all these echoes. And good Jewish boys that they were, the disciples were getting the message loud and clear as to who Jesus was. There's the mountain echoing that ancient Mount Sinai where God met with Moses. There's Moses and Elijah, the presence of Moses, the great lawgiver who received the law on the mountaintop. This points to Jesus, who is fulfillment of the law. Moses, who having spent time on the mountaintop, was also described as having a bright and shining face when he came back down from that time. And Elijah, that great prophet and priest, also had experience of hearing God on a mountain. And his presence points to Jesus as the great high priest. Both Elijah and Moses validate Jesus' identity as the Messiah, the focus of salvation, the hope for humanity, the key to the gate of life. And when the mysterious cloud descends, there's the voice of God. It leaves the disciples in no doubt. This is my son, my chosen. Listen to him. The disciples' minds are blown by all that they've been seeing and hearing. This is a vision of glory, like nothing they've ever known. And then the moment passes and they head back down from the glory of the mountain and back into the demands of the grey everyday. They come back down to the plain, to the chaos, the crowds, the confusion, the great sea of need and pain and fear and hope, and Jesus gets on with it. An anxious father brings his poorly son who is made well. And at the end of the passage, there's just a wee reminder here of the glory in the grey. And all were astounded at the greatness of God. What's our takeaway from this strange passage? Well, so many things, but let's focus on one. In this current context of war in Ukraine, of war in Europe once more, something many of us thought we'd never see in our lifetime, I think that this is a passage that reminds us of who we follow. No ordinary rabbi, no ordinary human, no ordinary man. Human, yes, but also divine. We follow the Messiah. It is he who walks with us in the Spirit. It is he who shines the light in the dark places where our fears gather and multiply. It is he in whom we hope that this world will be transformed, transfigured by the light of God's glory, redeemed from its brokenness, redeemed from its bitterness, redeemed from the lust for power at any cost. On Friday, Pope Francis said that every war leaves our world worse than it was before. War is a failure of politics and humanity, a shameful capitulation, a stinging defeat before the forces of evil. The story of the Transfiguration reminds us of the one who truly understands what real power is, and that real power is found in love and service to God and to neighbor near and far, and also to making our world better, so much better than it was before. We follow Christ, the Messiah, the chosen one of God, who, having defeated death itself and left us with his Spirit, calls us to be his body, his hands and feet. As those who follow Jesus, the Prince of Peace, so we seek peace and pursue it. Not a phony peace that is born of looking the other way or keeping our heads below the parapet. We seek God's peace, the peace that brings reconciliation between enemies, the peace that brings life. We use our voices to protest and to challenge the hawks of war. We use our voices to comfort and encourage the ones beaten down and oppressed. We use our choices through boycott and sanctions. And we use our gifts of compassion and hospitality to welcome and to care for the refugee, whether face to face or by giving to agencies that are set up to do that work. We seek God's peace, for that is God's vision for the world. It's a peace that comes with cost, because it may mean that there'll be a time when we're called to stand up and challenge tyrants and bullies. But we follow the one who went to hell and back to bring in God's kingdom, a kingdom in which we are invited to work towards, showing God's glory in the grey. In these strange days where we see tanks rolling through the streets of Kiev, and on any day when we see darkness, the darkness of oppression rolling in, may our hands and our feet, our whole selves, be put to work in bringing peace. And may our faces shine. May we be beacons of God's love, bringers of God's hope, bearers of God's peace. May it be so, and may the curse of war be beaten by the power of love. Let's pray. Loving God, we may not be able to confront queens or challenge presidents. We may not have the capacity to divert resources or uplift communities. We may not have the voice to silence the noise of war or the words to negotiate peace between armies. But as we follow you, O Lord, we are able to do something. And so we pray that you would inspire us to commit to and act on the small difference we can make. May we bring peace through small acts of gentleness and reconciliation. May we bring wealth through small contributions and collaborations. May we bring safety through small acts of consideration and acceptance. May we bring wholeness through small acts of care and service. And in the small ways, O God, may our small difference make a big contribution to your saving work in our world. Amen. Time now for some quiet reflection as we think of Christ upon the mountain peak. We come before God in prayer once more to dedicate our offering, to give our thanks, and to offer to God our prayer concerns. So let us pray. Accept, O God, our offerings of ourselves and our gifts. Make use of all that we have and all that we are to transfigure our communities and beyond, and so to bring in your kingdom. Loving God, this time 2 years ago, the world began to change as the pandemic took hold. It set us on a path we couldn't have imagined, a roller coaster of fear and despair. We thank you for being with us every step of the way. Thank you for the times when we witnessed the best of humanity, for those who selflessly worked to save lives, produce vaccines, and keep the country running. For those who raised funds and spirits, For every time you sent someone or something to lift us up, O Lord, we give thanks and praise. For every day you helped us to carry on when the tunnel was long and the light at the end of it was dim. We praise your holy name. The world has changed and we have been changed. Let us take what we have seen and learnt to light our pilgrim way evermore and to make our new normal better than our old normal. Loving God, your presence makes the face shine, the spirit soar, the heart beat. Your presence breaks the stony rules, the hard heart, the silent grief. Your presence fills the mountaintop, the earth below, the waiting crowd. Your presence changes the old ways, the trodden paths, the wasted lives. Loving God, make your presence felt where the darkness is too deep, the grief too sore, the divisions too wide, the sorrow too long, the pain too harsh for mere mortal hands to make whole and well. We pray especially for all caught up in the current conflict in the Ukraine, those seeking shelter from harm, those countries opening their borders to help, those fighting in danger of hurt and harm. You whose Son is Prince of Peace, bring healing, bring peace. Loving God, make your presence felt where the thirst is so great, the hunger so rooted, the spirit so afflicted, the heart so weary, the mind so distracted that earthly things cannot soothe or console. We pray especially for all struggling with higher grocery and fuel bills, all making painful choices between heating and eating, all who are caught in the cycle of poverty and who see no way of getting out, all who are living with these extra anxieties. And we remember too agencies and volunteers who give of their time and energy to help and to advocate for those on the margins. You whose Son spoke of fullness of life, bring hope and light in the darkness. Loving God, make your presence felt in us and through us, that lives be transformed, faces be transfigured by the glorious grace of you, you Father, Son, and Spirit. We pray for those in our parish, in our village communities, our neighbours and friends, for all the hidden and not so hidden needs around us. Teach us again and again your way of loving kindness, so that our lives reflect your glory. And in a time of quiet prayer, we bring before you all who are on our minds and in our hearts at this time, and we pray for our own particular needs. Loving God, we thank you that you are transforming us every day. We pray that not only will we have mountaintop experiences, but also that we will know your presence with us in our everyday and ordinary moments. May we be continually astounded at your greatness, and may it show in our lives. We offer up these prayers in Jesus' name. Amen. Our closing hymn is Shine, Jesus, Shine. Our time of worship draws to a close, and we finish in that time-honoured tradition. We close with a blessing. So go in peace and meet God in the extraordinary and in the ordinary. Go and listen, go and hear, go and respond. And know that God will give you peace. And as you go from this time of worship, may the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you all evermore. Amen. Our time of worship as God's community is finished. Our time for being bringers of God's transformation into the lives of others and into the life of the world begins. So until next time, take care, God bless, and goodbye for now.
This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. You know this little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Let it shine, shine, shine. Everywhere I go, I mean to let it shine. Everywhere I go, I mean to let it shine.